Repeaters and comparators, while being some of the oldest redstone components in the game, are often overlooked and their most interesting features are almost unknown. So let's change that, shall we? Hello everyone, my name's MD and welcome back to Practical Redstone Reloaded, the series in which I teach you how redstone works so that you can build your own farms and contraptions. In this episode, as mentioned before, we'll be looking at repeaters and comparators, two similar looking blocks but functionally they're as different as night and day. Let's start with the repeater. A block mainly used to either extend the range of a redstone signal or to delay that redstone signal. There's also a lesser known third function, which we'll get into a little later. First, we'll take a closer look at the block itself. The repeater needs a surface with a solid rim to be placed on and has four functional sides. You identify the sides with respect to the torch stubs and this red track it has. The side with the torch stub that's not in the track is the output. This is where the repeater will provide power. The opposite side with the track is the input. This is where the repeater receives power. The remaining two sides are for input from other repeaters and comparators for locking. Again, we'll discuss that later. Like redstone dust, a repeater doesn't do anything by default. However, when there's a block on the input side that gets powered, or is a source of power, after a delay of 2 game ticks, the repeater will turn on, and you will see it powers the block in front of it. Since the repeater has only one input side and one output side, it acts as a diode, only allowing power to go one way. Another thing you'll notice is that no matter the power level going into the repeater, the output is always at a full power level of 15. So repeater is a way to extend the range of a redstone signal at the cost of a slight delay. The specialty of the repeater is the fact that you can actually change the delay between the input and output by right-clicking the repeater. Each time you click, it increases the delay by 2 game ticks, up to 8 game ticks. So default 2, then 4, 6, and 8. Clicking it after the final setting resets it back to 2 game ticks of delay. Since the last episode, I hope you understood how game ticks are used to measure time, so a quick question to you. What is the smallest combination of repeaters we can use to get 1 second of delay? Take a second to think about it. Got your answer? Well, if you set 3 repeaters on 8, 8, and 4 game ticks, you'd be correct. If you add them up, you get 20 game ticks, which as we know is 1 second. There's a side effect of delaying with a repeater. What do you think happens when I input a pulse that's shorter than the delay the repeater has? For example, a 2 game tick pulse into an 8 game tick repeater. Would the output pulse still be 2 game ticks long? When you try it out, you find that's not the case. A repeater will never output a pulse less than the delay it has. That's why if you want to delay a short pulse without changing its length, you'd have to chain repeaters with an equivalent delay. Finally, the last feature of a repeater which I hinted at earlier and which many people don't know is the ability to lock the output of the repeater at any point. The way to do this is by running power from another repeater or comparator into the side of the repeater. When this happens, the torch stub in the track is replaced with a bar of bedrock and the repeater gets stuck in whatever state it was before you locked it. The only way to unlock it is by removing the side input power. That's all with repeaters for now, so how about we move on to the comparator? Comparators like repeaters have an input side in the back, where the double torch stubs are, an output side in the front with the small torch stub, and two side inputs, which unlike the repeater can also take redstone dust and redstone blocks as an input. The comparator has the same placement and powering behavior as the repeater, that is both input and output power can transfer through conductive blocks, and it also has a delay between input and output of 2 game ticks. Comparators have a variety of uses from signal comparison, container fill level measurement, power level operations, and more. So it's important to have a clear understanding of just how it works so it doesn't seem like magic. We'll start off simple. The core mechanics of the comparator are to, well, compare inputs. The comparator has the ability to compare the main input to either of its side inputs. If the main input has a higher or the same power level than both the side inputs, it'll output whatever the main input power level is. If any of the side inputs are greater, the comparator will not give an output. Let's look at some more examples of the comparison feature. As I said before, the main input has to be greater than or equal to both the side inputs, if they exist. So if one is at 4 and the other is at 6, the comparator will only give an output when the main input is 6 or more. It's possible to give variable power level inputs into the sides with another comparator or redstone dust. But if you place a repeater or redstone block into the side, then the side input has a full power of 15, and the only way the comparator can turn on is if the main input is also 15. Note that without any side inputs, the power level going out of the comparator will be the same as the one going in. It doesn't reset the power to full like a repeater. This behavior is really useful to carry information encoded in signal strengths over long distances, since the power level does not decay. Another very common use is in what is called a comparator fadeout clock or decay clock. This is a simple circuit that is used to extend the duration of an input pulse. The way it's done is a simple loop of comparators, but every time it goes around, the power level is allowed to drop by 1. What this does is every time the power loops, it drops in power all the way down to 0 when it turns off. The time it takes depends on both the amount of comparators in the loop and the amount of power that drops every loop. With 2 comparators and 1 drop per loop, we can have an extension of 60 game ticks, since 15 power levels dropping every 4 game ticks takes 60 game ticks to happen. One thing you have to be careful of is having the input pulse to a fader be less than the time it takes to loop. If that happens, then you end up with a clock that stops after a while instead of a constant signal, which in most cases isn't really that useful. A common mistake some people make with comparator faders is not having the power decay per loop, which just leads to the loop maintaining whatever power level was put in. This becomes a simple hexadecimal memory cell. You can take an output from it as well as input and modify the cell value. If you accidentally right-click the comparator after placing it, you would have noticed the start stub in the front turn on. This stub denotes whether or not the comparator is in subtract mode. Subtract mode, as you can imagine, changes just one thing. Instead of comparing the inputs, the comparator will now subtract the side input from the main input. So as you can see, 10 in the main input minus 7 from the side input gives an output of 3. It's important to note that when you have two side inputs on subtract mode, only the highest one is considered for subtraction. So the same thing with another side input of 5 still gives an output of 3. Now for the most popular and arguably most important feature of a comparator, the container measurement. Comparators have the unique ability to detect how full a container block is and translate that into a redstone signal. This ability works with all the containers you see here, and the way it does it is quite interesting. Put simply, the comparator checks every slot in the container and takes an average of how full each slot is. It takes this average and multiplies it by 14, then rounds it down. Finally, if the container is not empty, it adds 1 to whatever this value is, and that becomes the output. It's important to note that how full each slot is depends on the maximum stack size of that item. So a non-stackable item is equal to a full slot of 64 seeds or 16 snowballs. Some notes. A comparator reading a double chest will read all 54 slots, not just the one behind it. A chest that is blocked from opening will not give a comparator output. Minecart containers can be read when they are on a detector rail. Crafters are the main exception to the container fullness calculation. They have a different method to calculate the output, which we'll cover later. There are other blocks that a comparator can read that aren't item containers. Most of these are simple block states, and you can refer to the wiki for more information, so I'll quickly go through them. Beehives and nests give a power of 0 to 5 depending on how much honey is in the hive. Cakes give a power of 14 when full and decrease by 2 for every slice you eat. Cauldrons give an output of 0 to 3 based on the level of powdered snow or water in them. With lava, the output is always 3. Chisel bookshelves give an output of 0 by default, but whenever you interact with the slot of the shelf, the comparator output becomes the number of the slot from 1 to 6 you last interacted with. Composters give an output of 0 to 8 depending on how many levels of compost are in it, but you can't get an output of 7 for long because it quickly turns to 8 when the compost forms. Copper bulbs are simple, output of 0 when off and output of 15 when on. Command blocks also work with comparators, although you'd almost never use it. It gives an output of how many times the command it ran succeeded. Crafters give an output from 0 to 9 depending on how many of its slots either have an item or are blocked. End portal frames are a funny one, but they do work. No power by default, full power 15 when there's an eye in the frame. Item frames can also be read, but only when they are placed on the opposite side of a block the comparator is reading. The comparator output is dictated by the rotation of the item in the frame, going from 1 to 8. Jukeboxes also give a comparator output depending on which disc was put in it. Lecterns use the formula you see here to get the output. In most cases though, you just make a book with 15 pages, as each page gets its own matching power level. The charge level of respawn anchors can also be read, values of 0, 3, 7, 11, and 15. Lastly, a comparator can be used to read the output of a skulk sensor when it detects a vibration. One thing I forgot to mention about the containers is that the comparator can also read a container through a conductive block, not just the container itself. But if I asked you what would happen if I power this block with this dust line, what would be your answer? Does the comparator turn on or not? The block it's reading is getting power after all. If you answered yes, it does turn on, you'd be wrong. Kind of. Comparators will always prioritize reading the output of a container, even if that container is empty. But there's an exception. If the power running into the block on the comparator's input side is powered at full level 15, that power will override whatever the comparator would be reading from the container, and the comparator outputs a power of 15. This is a really handy and compact way of doing full container detection. There's a couple of other niche quirks of comparators that people exploit, namely comparator update detectors and instant comparator lines. But for a beginner, I don't think these are worth discussing in this video. If you are interested, I will link some videos in the description that cover them, and I do recommend checking them out. But with that out of the way, how about we move on to this episode's exercises? Like last episode, you are only allowed to use the components covered in this episode and the ones before it. No other components are allowed. First up is a simple one I call the button hold. Design a circuit that gives an output when a button is pressed 3 times in a row without gaps. Bonus points if the output is a short pulse, so it can't be kept on by holding the button for longer. Next is a slightly trickier one, the loop lock. Build a slow clock that sends a pulse through a loop of redstone lamps spaced apart. The catch is that at any point with the flick of a lever, you should be able to stop the pulse at the lamp it's on. Another one of similar difficulty is the lamp countdown. Have a vertical column of lamps that after a button press, slowly go from all lit down to none. For an additional challenge, see if you can wire it to only decrease by 1 with each button press, and a reset button. Finally, a little challenge. Build a circuit that selects 1 output out of 10 when the equivalent power level is provided. Use a 15-page lectern as the input. You can expand to 15 outputs if you'd like, and for the real tryhards, you can wire the outputs to a 7-segment display. Like last time, if you need help with these exercises, or if you'd like to share your attempts, then head on over to the NubTech Discord, grab the Practical Redstone tag, and check out the relevant channels. With that, we come to the end of the video. I hope you found it useful. Kindly drop a like and share the video to help support me. Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see future episodes, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching.